the National Child Protection Framework does not include any strategies to meet the needs of culturally diverse children and families even today. So that's something that I want to put on the topic. So as you will notice in the written submission, one of the key points, I guess, what I felt obliged to sort of wanting, child protection inquiries do provide an opportunity for governments to examine current practices, policies and legislative provisions and influence child protection policy making. So as I've mentioned over the past 5 years, I've been trying to advocate and raise this issue in different forms. One of the key responses I have received from government has been, we don't have the data or evidence to argue for a specific strategy to meet the needs of CALD communities in the child protection system. So, governments have found that because we don't have the data, we don't actually have to do anything. My argument is that that's not good enough. And you need to be more proactive in collecting the data. You need to recognize this is a whole section of the community that you are not meeting their needs and you're not changing your practice. And some of the preliminary research that has come out in 2008, the New South Wales Multicultural Services Unit estimated that 15% of children in the child protection system spoke at a second language light. So 15%. And then from some of the evidence from my research was that half of the child protection workers came into contact with CALD families between once a week and once a month when they were conducting investigations and assessments. So that's still evidence to show that there's a significant proportion of culturally diverse families coming to the attention of child protection authorities to validate that governments need to do something to change their service provision. So my aim and objective as part of this policy proposal was to present this evidence to this inquiry and also persuade this inquiry to consider developing a multicultural child protection strategy. So that this will then meet the needs of culturally diverse communities who come to the attention of child protection authorities. And as part of this policy proposal, I have made a number of recommendations, as you will see in what I did in developing this policy proposal was I actually examined all the current publicly available documents from the Department of Human Services website, including legislation, policies and procedure guidelines, and examined the provisions that were currently also within the Victorian Multicultural Legislation and Policy Framework. So, some of the key areas that I'm wanting to, recommend that DHS do is to improve their data system and capture CALD status as a priority. To ensure that systems are developed to capture ethnicity, religion, language on their locations, and children placed in out-of-home care. For DHS to work with refugee settlement and migrant services to develop culturally appropriate information and awareness programs for CALD communities, including migrants and refugees. To ensure that they are aware of the child protection laws and provided with the knowledge of Australian accepted parenting practices upon arrival. So there are a number of resources that are still available across the jurisdictions that Victoria could utilise. DHS to undertake an evaluation of current family services to assess whether they are culturally responsive to the needs of CALD communities based on the population demographics. So, given the population demographics of Victoria, it's quite diverse. I'm sure there would be different pockets and different suburbs and locations where there are high migrant or refugee communities in those locations. So what I want to look at for the family support services is actually to explore what are they reaching out to those vulnerable communities in that location. So when I did explore the DHS's legislation, there were a number of provisions within the Act that looked at ensuring that the needs of cultural identity, needs of children that came into the system were met, especially the best interest principle. My main concern was that it was unknown how those principles that are embedded in the legislation are being followed and adhered to by frontline child protection practitioners and whether they were familiar with those legislative provisions. when I looked at the Victorian Child Protection Practice Manual, I could not find any procedure guidelines that existed. So one of the recommendations is that they need to develop some procedure guidelines for frontline staff and how would they engage with culturally diverse families, incorporating those legislative provisions. Okay, so one of the other areas was looking at my research when I conducted that, looked at cultural competence and the consequent research that has come out from South Australia and New South Wales has highlighted that one of the key areas that child protection authorities can do to ensure that culturally diverse families don't come into the system unnecessarily is to build in cultural competence training and having cultural competent practice for frontline workers. So one of the recommendations that I put forward is that, you know, the department to provide mandatory cultural competence training for frontline staff to ensure that they have those guidelines and have an understanding of that working with culturally diverse families. And also the second side of it is to do the out-of-home care system. So currently in Victoria there are more than 5,000 children in care, those are the figures that I was able to find. We don't know how many of those 5,000 children in care are from a culturally diverse background. Then, for those children that are from a CALD background, how many are placed with kinship placement, culturally matched placement, or in a generalist placement? You know, how are those needs, cultural needs, being met while that child is placed in out-of-home care? So those are some of the strategies, I guess, in keeping in line with the terms of reference and the guidelines that we put forward, this is what I've sort of come up with at the moment. Luckily for me, having been a member of the National Framework, I was also able to get some of the interstate initiatives, and I've included that in Appendix B. Yeah, so from my perspective, I do believe that New South Wales is leading the way in actually building a very culturally responsive system in different waves and forms. But I did receive Victoria's information, but that was on Friday last week, so I wasn't able to actually analyse that information with what I had proposed. That's it.
That's most helpful. You've rightly identified data as an essential step to proceed, it's actually been most valuable.
And some of the outcomes and the published report, had a look at what was published in March this year. There's a significant vulnerability that exists for CALD communities in actually reaching the numeracy literacy levels and some of the developmental milestones. I think what I have found is that because there are different departments, there are different ministers, in government, and I'm a former public servant, so I do know a bit about government, and the policies, is that there's a huge disconnect. And I've noticed that particularly within the Commonwealth and also at state levels, that you will find some best practice happening, say, in health. I can give an example of some work that I've done with Queensland Health in developing a multicultural capability framework. So this is looking at how can clinicians develop that cultural competency and having some of that awareness about what sort of questions to ask, about stigma, so if you look in a mental health context or even infant mental health. And so there's practice guidelines that are being developed. That's great, but that's only for Queensland Health. That won't extend to education. So some of my experience with education, I found that some teachers, not all, have a real reluctance to sort of put in that extra effort to actually understand some of the vulnerabilities that might exist for non-English speaking or culturally diverse children who are really struggling to reach their developmental milestones and their, numeracy and literacy levels. So it's about that disconnect. And I think, over the past 5 years, it hasn't really come together yet. And that's why I felt it quite important to sit here and actually talk about it, because no one's talking about it. So I don't know if that answers the question.
Mr. Scott?
No.